Hello and welcome. Today we're going to look at X-Plane 11, and specifically we're going to focus on autopilot and using the flight management computer, FMC. Some might call it FMS, flight management system, whatever the terminology. You know, when you're flying an advanced modern airliner, I mean, the bottom line end result you're looking for is you want to be able to program a flight plan into the system, and you want the aircraft autopilot to fly it. It's a very simple concept. Unfortunately, it's not terribly simple to execute. What I'm going to do today is I'm going to show how I learned it, removed the complexity, and learn piece by piece, and bring my knowledge and competency level up to the point where I can program a flight plan and have autopilot fly it. I'm in the Zeebo 737 today. I chose it simply because I've been flying it a lot and I like it, and I know it's very popular. So there's probably gonna be a lot of people that benefit from this specific aircraft being used. But the concepts translate to whatever aircraft one is using. You'll find that the flight management system in the default planes that come with X-Plane 11 are typically watered down. While that does make it easier to learn, it also makes it where you don't really learn it, and then you try to use an outstanding freeware aircraft like the Zeebo 737, or you buy a great payware aircraft like Flight Factor 757-200, and you quickly learn that you don't know as much as you thought you did. So that's why I'm using the Zeebo, so that we have a little bit of the added complexity. And I probably should have started this aircraft running. We'll get it going, just bear with me. We need to get these up and aligned, otherwise we don't get avionics, right? That's the first thing you notice when you're using an aircraft that really models things realistically. You don't get a lot of your basic avionics if you don't go through the process of at least initializing your position. And let me slow down there and let's look at it again, and I'll talk through it. What I did is I stretched my neck all the way back here and I put the IRS into nav mode. And when I did that, you might have noticed it flashed on DC for a second, then it went to align both the left and the right systems. Once you do that, the FMC is going to want you to put in your position. And see, it just popped up. Anytime your FMC gives you a message, it's going to pop up, notify you that you should put your attention on the FMC. We're on the ground, so it's not terribly important, but if you're in the air and you see that, you definitely want to look at your FMC and see what the issue is. And what we're doing is simply entering the position. It's saying enter IRS position. Yes, we know, so I'm going to hit the clear button and I'm going to go into the position init screen. And all you really have to do here is put the airport you're at. There's a place to put the gate, but I never do, and things work fine. And you want to put the GPS position right here in this block. And what makes it a little bit challenging with this aircraft is there are multiple pages here, and you don't see them all. You have to go to the next page, where you see your GPS left and right systems, and here's your position. Luckily, you don't have to copy it down. You can hit the key next to it, and that puts it in your scratch pad. Then go back to the previous page, and you hit this key, and it's going to paste that in. Now we've put our position in, and you see as soon as we did that, these multifunction displays came alive. And I'm going to put the airport we're at. Oh, it was already there. I didn't need to do that, and just hit there to paste it there. We're going to just take off from 1W31, and we'll say our destination is for now. Now we'll put Newark. And go on to the next thing, which is performance init. Let's pause there for a second. Let me talk about what I'm going to do. I'm going to get us in the air, and we're just going to use the autopilot. And I'll show you what I mean by that, but we're going to use the autopilot to fly the aircraft, manage speed, altitude, and heading. And that's really where you want to start first. And you really don't need to go through all of this just to get the bird in the air and do that. So we're going to come back to this when we're ready to look at how the FMC plays into the whole thing. Right now we're just going to take off without any care or regard to our weight and balance and whatnot. We do have a good amount of fuel. We'll start engines. We are going to need a pushback, and I recently started using better pushback, and I like it a lot.
Cockpit plan acknowledged. Call me through the menu when you are ready.
And we're going to need some charts, or at least I do. Aviator tablet, wonderful. Freeware, you gotta have it. Especially if you have a Navigraph. Subscription. Here's where we are. I said 3-1, so this will help me understand where to taxi. And we'll go ahead and call.
Ground to cockpit. Tow is driving up.
Call the pushback. And we'll get on APU power. You may have just saw that light. And we'll get off of ground power. Oh, it says, I guess I didn't have the ground power unit connected. Make sure we're in the appropriate settings for engine start and takeoff. It looks like we basically are. Our pushback.
Okay, all doors and hatches are closed, ready to connect.
Are they really though? Yes, they are. He's going to connect. And like I said, I stopped after putting in the position and just the basic airport we're starting from and the airport we're going to end at. And I'm not going to program any more in. And the reason is because I don't intend to really use the flight management system integrated with the autopilot. I'm just going to use the autopilot for the time being.
So connected and bypass pin inserted. Release parking brake.
We're going to get takeoff config warnings when we take off because I didn't put in all the weight and balance stuff and determine the appropriate takeoff configuration, but we'll muscle through it. And I can't engage LNAV or VNAV because I haven't finished what I need to do here. We will get to that, but for now we're just gonna pretend we don't even know about it and just use the autopilot. Not so sure.
Starting pushback, and you may start engines.
Not sure better pushback quite has all the kinks worked out of it, because sometimes it doesn't detect pushing the key that controls the brakes, as you probably just saw. Start number two. They're supposed to let N2 spool up to 25. I'm gonna short circuit it a little bit. Starter valve is open because we did that, which does open the starter valve. When that closes, which it should soon, there it goes. And that also makes that switch back bounce back to auto. Now we can do the second engine. Same thing, I'm gonna be a little premature with it. Now this is not gonna be an example of a good landing, a good takeoff. Alright. Put our
operation complete. Set parking brake.
Put our
disconnecting tow, standby.
Altitude to 18,000. That's what we'll climb to. That's it. You know what? We don't even need to climb that high. We'll do 12 for the purpose of what we're doing here. I typically do program the altitude while we're waiting. The heading is 31, is 314.
Is disconnected and bypass pin has been removed. Hand signal will be on the right. We'll see you next time and have a great flight.
All right. Now we can put our packs on, go on generator and kill the auxiliary power unit, the APU. I'm going to put flaps to 10 degrees for takeoff. Like I said, we're just winging it because we didn't program weight and balance. I do expect when I get to the runway, apply power past 50%, it's gonna give us a warning. Horn, and the warning is because the takeoff configuration isn't right. will probably break some rules about taxi speed too. Alright, so what I'm going to do is take off, and then we'll use autopilot to fly runway heading and climb to that altitude, 12,000 feet. Load any passengers or cargo. That's why the aircraft is so light and flying down taxiway with throttles all the way cut back to idle. Arm auto throttle. Like I said, I'm expecting a warning horn as soon as we get throttles up. Alright. And I usually hold the brakes and go to about 50%. Make sure engines are stable. They are. Oh, we're not getting a warning. Okay. That's nice. Full throttle. N1. Let off the brakes. Because we're so low,
80 knots.
So light, I'm going to pull back at about 125. Notice he didn't call V1 or rotate because we didn't program our takeoff configuration, did we?
400.
And like I said, we're going to use autopilot to fly runway heading, so I'm going to hit
1,000.
That and command it. As I bumped the trim on my actual device. So it's going to stay on heading 315 because I have it in heading select mode. I've commanded it. It's not doing anything with altitude yet. Look how we're climbing at a ridiculous rate. So the VS vertical speed, want to command that, and no, we don't want it at 3,000 feet per minute. There. All this beeping is because I'm exceeding all kinds of things, but basically I have it in this mode where it's going to climb airspeed is... Oh, because I have this set too low. Been a long time since I just used autopilot. So when I commanded it, it also went into speed mode, which was still set for like 130, which is too low. That's why the airspeed was too low. Alright, now that I've raised that, put it at 240. Runway heading 314, 240 knots, climbing to 12,000 at 2,000 feet per minute, which we can see here. And it's 2050 feet per minute to be precise is what we're actually doing. We can see that we have our altitude set here. We can see that we have our speed set here. And what will happen is when the aircraft reaches 12,000, it's going to level itself off, because that's what autopilot does when it reaches the altitude you have specifically set in the MCP, which is this panel, is your MCP panel. Now, we'll put this away for now. We don't have to stay flying runway heading. We can change this. And I'll change it to, say, 270. And you'll notice here, the magenta line, which is our heading bug, moved to 270, and you can see the aircraft is banking appropriately. And it's going to go to 270. And it's going to hold that.
From all of us at American Airlines, thank you for flying with us today. We're proud to be Air
but we're
Transport
still climbing.
World's 2017 Airline of the Year.
To 12,000.
A special welcome to Advantage in One World members. If you are not an Advantage member, you can sign up at aa.com/join to earn miles for today's flight.
We can steer, however,
and continue earning miles with our retail and travel partners.
However we want, or if we were under air traffic control, more realistically.
Our Advantage Aviator MasterCard
however,
is
air traffic
way to
control
earn miles for everyday purchases
directs
and
you
enjoy
to
benefits.
Turn to heading whatever.
Free, preferred boarding, and no foreign transaction fees. Not an aviator card member? See a flight attendant.
Now we're getting
and
close to 12,000.
When you apply in flight today.
You see the aircraft, the autopilot is
shortly,
leveling us off.
We will begin our in-flight service. We offer a selection
and when that happens,
of complimentary
see this automatically went to
Wi-Fi
altitude hold mode.
Is available on this flight. Connect to the AA in-flight signal. And, open
and
your
the throttles are way back because I still have 250 knots selected
and other
now that we're over 10,000.
If you need to power your device, AC power outlets are located at every seat. While you are seated, please keep your seatbelt fastened and visible to the crew when the seatbelt sign is on, as turbulence can happen unexpectedly. If you open an overhead compartment,
we'll go to Mach
use caution,
0.6.
As carry-on items may have shifted during takeoff.
It's like we're oversped. Oh, I still have the flaps extended, that's why. Alright. And like I said, we can steer. However, we're going to turn left heading 120. And you see me controlling speed. I'm using Mach here. Don't know why it had that B in front of it. Yeah, 322 might be a little high. We're just going to go to... Oh, we are at 322. We'll go back down to 300. Like you just saw me literally do, we can control our speed right here. Whatever I set, because we're in speed mode, it's going to hold that. You can see we're decreasing speed here. Now we're at 300. So throttle's up slightly, and we're no longer losing airspeed. autopilot is managing the speed as per what we instructed. And it's still in the process of that turn to 120. You can see we're almost there. And it's going to level off. Now let's talk about altitude. What do we want to do if we want to go down? Well, you just flip this altitude down to 8,000, say we want to go. Uh-oh, that didn't work. Why? Well, that's the thing about the MCP. The altitude you have set here, once you're in altitude hold mode, it's going to continue to hold that 12,000 that we set. Moving this won't change that. What we do is we set the new altitude that we want to go to, and we'll say 5,000.
Ladies and gentlemen, we have a passenger, Escobar. Passenger Escobar, this is in regards to a special meal. Would you please identify yourself to a flight attendant? Passenger Escobar, please.
There's the infamous passenger Escobar. So I was saying we set the new altitude and we tell it to descend by going in the vertical speed mode and tell it down, nose down, and we'll descend at 1500 feet per minute. Now we still have speed mode engaged and we still have 300 set, so you're gonna see the autopilot is gonna reduce the throttles, because as we all know from fundamental flight, when you point your aircraft nose down, it's going to want to gain speed. So if you want to maintain 300, you need less thrust, otherwise you're going to gain speed. So this is what I would suggest people start with. Just get used to using autopilot to manage your climb and descent, holding of a desired or assigned altitude, manage your heading. We're going to turn left to 045, and manage your speed. It's really that simple. So if someone asks, how do I use autopilot? Well, this is how you use autopilot. Autopilot alone. It isn't terribly complex. Now, the question then becomes, okay, how do I use autopilot and the flight management system together so that I can automate flying a flight plan just like they do in real world? And that's what we're going to look at next. But first, we'll go ahead and we'll land at LaGuardia again. It's not an arrival, it's an approach. And we'll take an easy one, ILS to runway 4. And here we are, so I need to turn back towards this waypoint. So I will turn pretty much by 180 degrees. Now on your screen here, you can select waypoints so that you can see them on your screen, which is very helpful when you're not fully leveraging your flight management computer. I'm just pretending like we're in a learning stage before we've gotten to that point. And this is how I learned. I did just focus on how to use the autopilot. I actually did VOR to VOR navigation because I come from the old school to start out in these complex aircraft. in a pretty shallow bank, probably because I had accidentally bumped this inner dial, which tells the autopilot the max bank that it's allowed to do, which is usually at 30, which is a standard turn, and there's nothing wrong with doing a 30-degree turn, but that's why we were getting such a poor turning radius. Another reason we're getting such poor turning radius is because we're doing 300 knots and we're below 10,000, so we're in a lot of trouble for that. And you just heard the co-pilot call 1,000 to go. We were at 6,000 and we're descending to 5,000. We're almost there. I did back the speed off so it will decelerate. Turn it a little bit more. Oh, that's Mach speed. And you saw it got to 5,000 and it automatically went into altitude hold mode, and it's going to hold 5,000 from this point on until we tell it something else. Okay. And we're at 5,000. Now we're going to go down to, at green, we're supposed to be at 2,700. So I'm going to put 2,700 here. And I'm going to command it to descend at 1,500 feet per second. Negative 1,500 means down. And we're still trying to stay at 240 or less, and it's probably not going to be able to do it because we don't have any drag. It's staying in the ballpark, so we'll just let it be. You really shouldn't use the flaps as speed brakes, but we're going to need flaps anyway, so I'm going to go ahead and put out 5 degrees of flaps. And we needed to
1,000 to go.
Turn right. Kind of looking for green down here to see if I can find it. But I'm kind of using the tablet page over here to eyeball it, cheating a little bit. See green, but I do see proud, and I know that that is a waypoint. Notice I put the magenta line where it's basically resting on proud, and that will steer us to proud. And we're gonna go down to 200 knots. See, the speed is decreasing now because I did that. And I'm just trying to find green on this really seeing it. Alright, that's close enough. And I'll tell it 180 knots. And now that we're under 200, we can go to 10 on the flaps. And I'm going to tell it to descend to 1700. Because if we look at the approach, by the time we get to Dennis, which is where we're almost at, we should have been at 1700. And at this point,
2500.
We're gonna get the ILS going and use that, go into approach mode. I should have set the right courses. It's 044. We need to come way down in speed. And we're going to go into approach mode. Command. Well, I thought we were going to command both systems, but... Oh. We want to let it... We're below the glide path, so I'm just gonna take manual control. Get gear down. And get flaps down. We're quite a bit below the glide path. I'm trying to talk through this and do it at the same time is a little bit much. Try to put this bird on the ground without crashing everyone on board. I didn't really intend this to be a how to use the ILS video anyways. But I did intend to use autopilot to put us on a stabilized approach. Speed's a little bit low, I think. We're just guesstimating it because we didn't program our profile, weight balance, and all that good stuff, so I...
200.
I don't get that.
Think rate.
100.
Think rate. Think rate.
50. 40.
Think
30.
Rate.
1.
Think rate.
10.
And I forgot to arm the brakes. And we are back now for the second phase of this session. We're going to look at actually using the FMC. I'm just going to get us powered up quickly. This time we're going to put some people so that we get something that's representative of a real load. Alright, we'll get power. Physical throttles were advanced and they shouldn't have been. Early on in your flight, pre-flight process, you want to get your INS going and do your position init. We did this before. I'm in the position init screen. I want to put in my airport where I'm sitting, go to the next page, copy one of these, put it right there. We're going to do a short flight from New York to Philadelphia. Alignment is done, so we have our maps. We're gonna listen.
Lot underscore Guardia information X-ray.
Let's make sure 22 is still in use.
Wind 200 at 9 variable 180-240. Visibility more than 10. Sky conditions 4,700 broken, 6,700 broken, 25,000 broken. Temperature 29. Dew point 17. Altimeter 3003. Arriving runway 04. Departing runway 04. Advise on initial contact, you have X-ray.
Okay, so we've got our starting airport, our destination, and our runway. Now we also need a departure. And from LaGuardia, this HOPE 3 RNAV departure goes towards Philadelphia, which is good for us. So we're going to put in from the departure arrival page, departing KLGA. Oh, it's not an option from this specific runway, so we'll take the only one that is, which is LGA5. Now we have some legs in here. That's because the destination or the departure, LGA5, has been entered. And on the Philadelphia end, the GEMS 3 RNAV approach is what we're going to do. Again, from the departure arrival page, KPHIL arrivals, GEMS 3, and we want from Briggs. We'll take that. Now we've got stuff. Activate it. Execute it. We've got a discontinuity, and that's because we told it what airport we're leaving from and what departure. And on the other end, we've told it where we're going and the arrival, but we haven't filled in the middle. So we have a discontinuity. Well, to fix the discontinuity, I'm gonna simply say go straight to Briggs. And I do that by copying Briggs and putting it over the discontinuity, and then execute. Now we don't have a discontinuity, but we do have a vector, which is basically the system saying that the pilot's going to determine how we go from this point to Briggs for 80 nautical miles, which I would normally just erase the vector and tell it to go straight to Briggs. Instead of doing that, I'm going to insert RBV is Robbinsville VOR, which is, well, there it is, literally right there. Instead of vectoring, we're going to go to Robbinsville. And it gave us another discontinuity and more vectoring. Well, we're just going to get rid of the discontinuity and the vectoring. We're going to depart, go to RBV, then continue on to Briggs and the arrival. That's our routing. Now we need to fill out, usually from the position init screen, you go to route, and then after route, it kind of leads you right onto the performance init screen. This is where we tell the flight management computer important things like how much we weigh, how much fuel we have on board, what our center of gravity is, so that it can calculate all the things that it needs to calculate. Luckily, you don't have to actually go fetch most of these numbers. You just hit the key next to them, and it puts it in. And it knows we have 5,000 kilos of fuel. How much do we plan on using that? We'll say 4.5. We want to keep 0.5 as a reserve, which is emergency. The flight management computer should consider it off limits. Don't use it. And cost index, put in 1. That basically tells the flight management computer to consider this route is going to burn the typical amount of fuel. And the cruise altitude we're going to put in, we'll put in 20,000 feet because it is not far, and outside air is 30 c. We need to put it right here. And the other things, populate, execute. Now move on to N1. I don't change anything here. Move on to takeoff. This is where we tell it how we want to take off with 15 degrees of flaps. What our center of gravity is, you can just click there and it will automatically populate it, and now it tells you where your trim needs to be. It's 4. And then click on each one of these and it takes the recommended value. There you go. Now you're ready to take off. I like to put this one in here. And our courses for runway. What did it say? Runway 4? Yep, runway 4. I put that in all 3 of these. And we're going to 20. Put that there and also here. We're going to get ready to start up here.
flight attendants, please be seated for departure.
Okay, the cabin is secured. Have a good flight.
We'll need a push back. That's fine, actually.
Ground to cockpit. Plan acknowledged. Call me through the menu when you are ready. Ground to cockpit. Tow is driving up.
Start the APU. Flaps to 15. We did trim. Flight directors. Waiting for this to light so we can go off ground power.
Okay, all doors and hatches are closed, ready to connect.
Now I can go on APU power. Disconnect ground power. Flaps are at 10, we want it to 15. One more notch. Glancing over everything, we're going to go ahead and go to 2200. Turn that on.
Tow connected and bypass pin inserted. Release parking brake. Starting pushback. And you may start engines.
Thank you. We'll do that. Should get to 25, and then you turn on fuel. Valves open, that's normal. This switch will pop back to auto when, and this valve will go off when the engine is done starting.
Operation complete. Set parking brake. Disconnecting tow. Stand by.
Now I like to see if VNAV, we're not commanded, VNAV. If that can't be engaged, then you've made an error programming the stuff we just did. LNAV isn't usually available unless you're pointed in the right direction. So we're not going to worry about that for now. We're going to go ahead and put on those. We're going to go to generator power.
Echo is disconnected and bypass pin has been removed. Hand signal on the left. We'll see you next time and have a safe flight.
Got our packs on. We can turn off the APU. Lights. Everything's looking good. Weather on the other guy's view there. And we'll taxi. Well, while we taxi, I'll just recap what we did before. When we took off, we simply used autopilot to manage speed, heading, and altitude, which fundamentally, that is what it does. But we didn't use the flight management computer. We commanded it by setting the speed, altitude, vertical speed if we were climbing or descending, and the heading. So when you think about it, the flight management computer now takes on that role. And it can do that because we programmed in how much the aircraft weighs, how that weight is distributed, what the air temperature matters, and we told it the departure route, we told it the arrival route at our destination, and we programmed points in between. We told it how high we want to cruise. And with all of that information, it should be able to control the autopilot so that we're at the appropriate speed, heading, and altitude pretty much at all points throughout our flight plan. As we taxi, I just want to look at climb, make sure that's all filled out. Cruise. Descent is there. You know what, though? Let's look up before we run off the taxiway here. I like to tell it on the takeoff the noise abatement takeoff. It's usually required in big cities to cut back the throttle. It lowers noise and air pollution. You go to the takeoff reference, go to the next page, and you can say cut back on. You'll notice not long after we leave the ground, it's going to cut back the throttles. That can be alarming if you don't understand what's happening, why it's doing it. Up here and go for it. gets at our legs again. See if we can command LNAV. No, we can't from here, so I'm just going to put it in heading select mode. We're not commanded, so it's not doing anything. We want auto throttle on. Just run the engines up to about 50%. Make sure you're stable and you don't have any horns. And then you go. Hit the N1 button. And you might recall when we programmed one of those pages, it was called N1. We didn't change anything there. We took the defaults, but that is, all those values are what control
80 knots.
How much power to apply for the takeoff.
B1, rotate.
Here we go. Off the ground.
Positive rate.
Gear up. One notch of flaps is going up. Now we haven't commanded autopilot yet. We will.
400.
Let's see if we can get LNAV. Yeah, we can. Otherwise, I would have left it in heading select mode and we would have used autopilot. Here's the cutback that I talked about. And we're over 1,000. I'm going to command autopilot. LNAV didn't command, and it's probably saying why. No, actually it's not. So we're going to go in heading select mode. It's because we're flying in the wrong direction. So we're going to do a left-hand turn. I'm using the heading select mode. This is just like we did before. Usually this isn't necessary. But I've never flown this particular departure to a southern direction. Maybe that vectoring that was in there was there for a good reason, huh? Alright, but notice I don't have to do anything with our climb. It's handling it. It's still in N1 mode. It'll stay there throughout the climb. When it levels off, it'll no longer be full throttled. Well, it's technically not full throttled now either. But you notice it cut back the throttles, but now they're up again. Well, once you get to a certain altitude or a certain distance from the airport and or the metropolitan area, we're going to put flaps all the way up now, then you can use full throttle. Alright, and I'm going to use heading mode to steer right towards that point. As we get on a heading that's going to intercept that, we'll see if we can command LNAV and see if it does the right thing. And it looks like it is. So now we're in LNAV and VNAV mode, climbing to our cruise altitude of 20,000. And you'll see here on our display, I usually zoom out until you can see your next point. Remember that RBV, that's what we put in there. We said after the departure we want to go to RBV. Well, here you have your top of climb indicator telling you when you're going to reach the cruise altitude which you had put in. Usually just take another glance at switches and systems to make sure I didn't forget anything.
From all of us at American Airlines, thank you for flying with us today. We're proud to be Air Transport World's 2017 Airline of the Year. A special welcome to Advantage in One World members. If you are not an Advantage member, you can sign up at aa.com/join to earn miles for today's flight and continue earning miles with our retail and travel partners.
About
our Advantage Aviator MasterCard is another
intercept.
Great way to
so
earn
now
miles
it's
for everyday purchases and enjoy benefits,
turning.
Such as your first checked bag free, preferred boarding,
and we're going to be
no
on that
foreign
path.
Transaction fees. Not an Aviator card member? See a flight attendant and receive an exclusive offer when you apply in-flight today. Shortly, we will begin our in-flight service. We offer a selection of complimentary beverages. Wi-Fi service is available on this flight. Connect to the AA in-flight signal and open your browser. You can access AA.com free of charge to view flight connections and other travel information. If you need to power your device, AC power outlets are located at every seat. While you are seated, please keep your seatbelt fastened and visible to the crew when the seatbelt sign is on, as turbulence can happen unexpectedly. If you open an overhead compartment, use caution, as carry-on items may have shifted during takeoff.
Good as standard barometer. We're not far from our top of climb. And I mean, this really is the end goal when you set out to learn how to fly one of these jetliners. And when someone says, "Jay, you know, I'm having trouble with autopilot," usually it's not so much autopilot, it's the flight management computer aspect of it. And I personally learned it by separating the two out and understanding just the autopilot first. That's what I showed in the first segment. And then once you have a good understanding of how to manually control the autopilot, then having the flight management computer step in and do that role. But obviously it needs a lot of information in order to do that, and that's what we programmed in at the beginning. Oh, 20,000 is our top of climb. We're almost there.
1,000 to go.
Now you'll see the autopilot is going to level it off. It doesn't go into altitude hold mode, though, like it did when we were just using autopilot. There's a reason for that. It's still leveling off, but it's in VNAV mode, which means the autopilot is saying, "I am currently following the VNAV profile that is programmed in the FMC." So the altitude hold and the velocity speed, they don't like, and that's normal. And it's going to hit the cruise speed now, which, if we hit the cruise button, target speed 285 knots or 0.754 Mach, and that is where it's at right now. That gives us a ground speed of 361 knots. If we wanted that to be higher, which usually you do, you want it up in the 420 to 450 range, depending on winds, but you have to hit a higher altitude to hit those speeds. The reason has to do with air density and whatnot. The higher you go, the faster your plane will go, is pretty much all you need to know. And it's more fuel efficient too at the higher altitude versus the lower altitude. We could probably turn off the landing gear lights now that we've had the gear retracted for about a 15 minutes, huh? So at this point, it's kind of just sit and watch, supervise, as they say. But we're coming up on our arrival pretty soon. We're going to cross over this RBV point that we put in, and it's going to proceed on to Briggs, and that's where the arrival begins. And you can see we have a top of descent here. And why is that there? Let's look at our arrival, and look, we're already coming onto the screen. And if we read that, I'm a little confused, to be honest with you, because we're headed for Briggs. Yeah, I guess that's right. We're going to go here and then probably over. So I didn't give us the most direct route. But it's okay. We could actually kind of cheat. Well, we missed our opportunity. We just passed RBV, so. So now this is going to turn and head off in the direction of Briggs, which is says not to scale. It's off over here somewhere. So since we selected the Briggs, or the Jim's arrival via the Briggs transition, the published procedure is at Briggs, you should be at 14,000. We didn't put that in. Well, it says expect 14,000. We're going to be still at 19,200. If we wanted to change that, the first value is the airspeed, and we'll still say 240 knots, but let's say 14,000. Now watch what happens to this. Execute it. Now it's gonna be down to 14,000 when we get to Briggs, which I'm a little surprised it didn't automatically do that, because usually when you program an arrival, it gets you the right VNAV profile. So then after Briggs we go to IROCT, and our plan says we're gonna be at 10,760. At 9,000. And they got the Jim's point right. So we'll fix that one too. Now beyond that, we don't know, because we don't know what runway we're going to get. But it's time to start listening on the approach, not the approach, the arrival. The Addis frequency is here, 133.4. Put that in.
Philadelphia INTL information X-ray.
Let's see what runway we're going to get.
1800 Zulu weather. Wind light and variable. Visibility more than 10. Sky conditions 4000 scattered, 12000 scattered, 20000 scattered. Temperature 28, dew point 18. Altimeter 3002. Arriving runways 27 right, 35, 26. Departing runways 27 left, 35. Advise on initial contact, you have X-ray.
So 27, 35, or 26. And I'm looking at the directions here on this arrival.
Philadelphia INTL information X-ray.
26 or 27. We're going to turn him off.
Visibility more than 10.
So 26 or 27. Fly over Jim's. Just this point. On track 339 to Beals. Then to Wojcik. To Peace Out. And then they give you vectors to final. That seems a little bit out of our way, but we'll follow the procedure. So now we go into departure arrival, go to arrivals, Philadelphia. We already put this piece in, but we didn't know the runway, so now we're going to tell it the runway. We'll say 27 left. And usually you do pick the point. Let's look at that approach and make sure. See that point? Let's take a look at it. You can see we're getting told to reset the MCP altitude because we're almost at the top of descent. And if I don't lower this, that's not giving it permission to descend as per the VNAV profile. So if I hadn't done that, it would continue to stay flying at, instead of descending. Oh, and let's look at our legs now that I... So, yep, Jim's, San. I'm not seeing any of these. Oh, I picked the wrong runway, that's why. 27. SD Thorn. Yeah, we're not gonna go to this CYN. There. Message drag is required because it can't maintain the descent velocity and descend at the rate it needs without some drag, so I have to put the speed brakes out. Said we wanted to be at 14,000 when we got to brakes, and looks like we are. Now this time we will use the ILS. ILS or localizer runway 27 left. Usually it'll say here if autopilot coupled landing is allowed or not. Actually it's we'll say it's not. It doesn't say that here. I'm not gonna let it auto land. It's still saying drag is required, so. But we already got speed brakes out. There's not much I can do. Alright, so according to this approach, we should be at 3,000 when we get to Festi. And see, that is here. So this is all good. Festi. Anyone who plays Far Cry 5 will giggle at that one. If you don't, you're just gonna have to look it up. So using the flight management computer, the autopilot, all together, I haven't had one hand on any of the controls, including the throttle, since we engaged autopilot shortly after takeoff. Although I have used a hand to extend the speed brakes, but that's it. Oh, and we should have set our altimeter.
Philadelphia INTL information Yankee
3003
Zulu weather. Wind 170 at 5. Visibility more than 10. Rain. Sky conditions 4,000 few. 7,000 scattered. 20,000 scattered. Temperature 26.
Alright.
2.18. Altimeter 30.
And it's raining there, so. Shouldn't impact us too much, except wonder what the visibility is. You get a weather report inside Aviator's tablet as well, in METAR format. A3006 is the altimeter. I think these are scattered. Rain and thunderstorms. I think this is visibility. But I'm not the expert at reading a METAR, so we'll just listen to the
Philadelphia INTL
recording.
Information Yankee. 1800 Zulu weather. Wind 170 at 5. Visibility more than 10. Rain. Sky conditions 4,000 view. 7,000 scattered. 20,000 scattered. Temperature 26. Dew point 18. Altimeter 3003.
Alright, so visibility is still greater than 10 miles. 5 knot winds. It doesn't sound like it's thunderstorms, and visibility will be low. Wouldn't really matter because we're in an appropriate equipped aircraft. We could let autopilot land this thing if it was necessary. Usually you don't do that unless it is necessary. I like to let autopilot get me close, say down to 500 feet or so. In decent weather, and then fly at manually from that point. Alright, so one thing we need to start thinking about is there's one more piece of information that this thing needs to know. And we didn't do this earlier because it wouldn't have made sense, which is to fill out our approach. And the reason it wouldn't have made a lot of sense is because our weight changed between then and now. You can select your option 15 degrees 30 or 40 degrees flaps. I usually like to land with full flaps, so I'm going to select this one, 40 degree flaps. The VREF speed is 138 knots. So pick the one you want and then click this one, and now you've told the FMC what it needs to know in order to calculate the proper approach speed. Alright, so we're still on our departure, our arrival. And we've just come onto the screen on our approach, so I'll probably just look at it from here. And we are headed straight for Festi. Festi. Alright, I'll go ahead and say it. Far Cry 5, there's one mission, side mission actually, called the Testy Festy. And that's all I'll say about that. Look it up if you're curious. It was a funny mission. And we have a weather radar in this aircraft, and I had it on all the way. We don't really see much. We see a little bit of cloud. Well, it doesn't just show clouds, it shows clouds with significant moisture, which now we're in the rain, so. I guess I could have turned it on my screen too. I just usually don't like to clutter mine. And you can only have it on one side. And we still have our speed brakes up, but our throttle is fully cut, so. Put the speed brake just to the armed position. And we've about hit our deceleration. Now we have just hit our deceleration point. So now it wants us to decelerate. And we're well under 250 knots, so it is appropriate now to start putting the flaps out. And that will also create drag, and that's why put the speed brakes in the armed position instead of deployed. Now I'll go ahead and put flaps to 5 degrees for now. And the easiest way to set the frequencies is to do it from here. The heading for landing is 267, so we need to set these. Well, I mean, you don't have to, but if you want it to work. Can't tell you how many times I've forgot to set these. I mean, it'll take you somewhere, but it ain't gonna be where you want it to go. And now it's time to start thinking about this limit I have set. We want to let the flight management computer and the autopilot get us all the way down to 2060 without. So I'll put 2000. This doesn't tell it to descend now, it just means you have permission to descend down to 2000 as per the flight plan that you're holding. And Torn, yep, Torn should be 3000. And from Torn, then it's on final descent. So let me pull out another thing of flaps. I'll probably pull out a couple. And when we make that turn, I'll go into approach mode. Leave flaps there, because if I do full flaps without putting the gear down, we'll get a warning horn. You can, but I prefer not to pull the gear out until we're at least pointed somewhat towards the runway. See where we are. Kind of surprised it didn't start that turn a little sooner. I will put this MFD in approach mode, but I have not yet put the system in approach mode. I'll do that shortly. Here's the glide slope. It's not quite alive yet, meaning we're still so far below it. Now it's starting to move. So yeah, it is time to pull out the gear. Gear all the way down. And the full flaps. And kind of supervise that this thing gets on good approach. Notice we don't have a speed indicator here yet. It'll show up shortly. And the speed is 138 plus 5. So 143 is what will probably pop up here. And I'm going to put the autopilot in approach mode. Engage both, 143, just like I said, and look, it's turning because it's intercepting the localizer, and it's about to capture the glide slope, and I don't think I need to, but I usually do tell it it's allowed to go further down. I think once you're in approach mode, it will just do it, but well, yeah, because usually you put your missed
2500
your missed approach heading or heading altitude in here, and yeah, it's captured glide slope localizer, and it's descending. Flaps are out, gear is out, automatic brakes are set, speed brake is armed. We are about ready. We'll just give the briefing here. Well, it ain't gonna be 10 minutes, but... So, it's gonna maintain 143 knots as it descends.
Be sure your seat
in accordance with the glide slope, locked onto the localizer.
If you have any items to discard, please pass them to us as we come through the aisle.
When we get to about 500 above ground, I'll disengage autopilot and auto throttle, and I'll take control, and hopefully not embarrass myself with a really, really poor landing. Haven't really mastered it yet in this aircraft.
We will let you know when it is safe to use cellular function. We'll be landing soon.
Landing lights would probably be appropriate. And I'm watching here is my altitude above ground. And this is going to turn into a circular display soon. And you'll hear the call outs. So, like I said, when this gets to about 500, I'll take control. There doesn't really seem to be any wind, turbulence, nothing. So there'll be no excuse for a poor landing. When we get on the ground, the priority turns to keeping the aircraft from taking off again.
500.
And decelerating. We'll use reverse thrusters for that. Or at 500, I'm going to disengage autopilot and auto throttle.
300.
And that's why we let the autopilot program.
Tank rate. Tank rate.
100.
Tank rate. Flight slow.
50. 40. 30,
20, 10. And reverse thrusters.
Eighty knots.
And then you take off the reverse thrusters. You use the brakes. You don't use reverse thrust at low speeds because it'll...
Please remain seated with your seatbelt fastened until the seatbelt sign is turned off. And keep the aisles clear of all carry-on items. Take a moment to check your seat back pocket for any personal items, like tablets and cell phones. When you open the overhead compartment, be careful, as items may have moved in flight. And thank you for choosing American Airlines.
Now, all that time I was running my mouth, I should have been getting the airport diagram out so that I knew, should I vacate the runway off to the left or right? Be a good idea to know where the hell you're going before you get there. Yeah, we made the right choice. And it's complaining about auto throttle not being engaged, and that's because it isn't engaged. That's fine. We don't want it to be. I usually take off the auto brakes, raise the speed brakes back up, raise the flaps, all back for the way it needs to be for the next person. say this must be cargo. We'll go to the normal terminals. And it's on the airport diagram, right over here. That pretty much wrap it up. A lot of time spent here. First, we talked about autopilot and just using autopilot. We used just the autopilot and we controlled speed, heading, and altitude. Then we brought the flight management computer into the fold. And we had to enter a lot of stuff. But once that stuff's entered, it's pretty much a hands-off exercise. But when you're learning, it's very frustrating because you forget to fill in one of those fields. And nothing works, pretty much. For those seeking really the best experience, especially if you crave realism, is seek out the Flight Crew Operations Manual, FCOM, or whatever aircraft you're flying. Follow the actual procedures. It will tell you all of that stuff. I mean, it may not tell you the values, neither did I. But it will tell you everything that needs to be put in to expect things to work. And we'll shut her down and call it a day. That will do it for today.